when my mom and her twin sister and her father and other siblings and nieces arrived at Auschwitz, the first thing that they heard and saw was this orchestra. And my mother turned to her twin sister and said, you know, took her by the arm, "See, it can't be all that bad, right? There's music here."
Stanley Burneff has a vivid memory of his arrival at the Mauthausen concentration camp in 1944. Burneff and his fellow Jewish prisoners were shipped to the camp in a cattle car and marched to the front gate.
The huge gate with the name on top in German, Arbeit macht frei, meaning work will make you free. As we entered, there's an orchestra playing Beethoven. It was an unbelievable sight. People were being killed and beaten, and there's an orchestra playing.
One day came to me a guy, he played on the way to the chamber, gas chamber. He stopped to play after the war, and as he has a grandchild, he wanted to repair the violin that he will play. I opened the violin. I remember there was inside black powder because it was played besides the crematorium and besides all these horrible places. And I asked him questions, and he told me about what happened there. He told me that people that played, they have seen the family going to the gas chamber. So through the violin, they were going together with them. They could not pray. The violin prayed for them. After the war, when all the atrocities that happened in Germany, in Poland, in other places, arrived to Israel, this is the most difficult time of my life. When I asked my mother, where is my grandfather, where is my grandmother, where is my aunts, where all the family, she used to take a book of Vilna to show me the Ponar forests where they killed all the Jewish people, 18,000 people, and say, "Here is your family." My father, when he learned what happened to his family, how he lost about 400 people, he never spoke again about the Holocaust, never. When the war ended, my father was the head of the Vilna Association in Israel. So many, many of the new immigrants who survived and escape came to our house for the first day in Israel. Nobody want to play on a German instrument. Nobody want to touch it anymore. So they came to my father and said to him, "If you are not buying this violin, I'm breaking it or burn it." And for my father, this was sacrilege. And he bought every instrument that people bring it to him. And he knew 100% he can never sell it again. He could not fix it, but he could not throw it away.
Amnon's spirit is expressed in the way he works. He brings the violins more to life than they were originally made for. He calls me sometimes and says, "Listen, there are those two sisters who came here, old ladies, who buried their violin in Holland underground and took it out after the war. And they brought me that violin. I'm going to bring it back to life."
The Holocaust is a story of death, but the Holocaust is also a story of hope, because many people survived. And the music was a part of it. When you know all the stories of the violin, you find that many violins brought hope with them. People that know to play very well and know to speak through the violin can tell you all the stories of the world. Each violin like this is a Jewish violin 100%. So we're buying every violin like this, or getting a gift every violin like this. We are restoring the violin. So now when you hear the violin again, he can pray. And if he can pray, he's talking for these people.
If you think about it, just over 70 years ago, Jewish people were not allowed to play. Only in camps, under the most terrible conditions. Today, we take these instruments to the biggest stages in the world.
Look, the Nazis are not anymore. The violins, they are. And the violin are playing. And when they are playing, this is victory. And when it is victory, you cannot take it away.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hermann Weinstein.